Hi everyone, Heather here with Astrology with Heather.com, and I am back with another special video. And today's topic is chart rulership. And so many of you might already be aware that you have a chart ruler, and some of you may not actually know what that means yet. And so that's what we're going to cover in this video. And even for those of you who are aware that you have a planetary ruler of your chart, you may not be clear on what to actually do with that information, how to use it, what it means. And so today we're going to be covering that topic relatively in depth. And this is something that I cover super in depth in my house rulerships course, which is a 4-week course, over 8 hours of lectures, tons of supplemental materials covering everything you need to know about house rulerships and astrology. And chart rulership is a form of house rulership, because what the chart ruler is it's actually the planet that rules the first house, or the planet that rules the ascendant sign. And so every single person has a chart ruler, and this is a planet that takes on some extra significance in astrology and in your personal chart, your personal life, and your personal experience. And so the way that you determine the chart ruler, for those who are not already super familiar with this concept, is you look to the ruler of the ascendant sign. And so if you have your ascendant in the sign of Aries, the chart ruler for you would be Mars. If you have your ascendant in the sign of Mercury, the chart ruler would be Mercury. If you have your ascendant in the sign of Taurus, it would be Venus. If you have your ascendant in the sign of Cancer, your chart ruler would be the moon. If you have your ascendant in Leo, it would be the sun. In Libra, it would be Venus, just like Taurus. In the sign of Scorpio, that's where things start to get a little bit different. And so the next thing I wanted to just kind of mention here is that some people are going to have more than one chart ruler. And so for those of you who have a Scorpio ascendant sign, you actually have both a modern and traditional ruler of your ascendant. And so in modern Western astrology, Scorpio is ruled by the planet Pluto, which is more newly discovered. It was discovered in, I think, 1931. And so we've only had Pluto for less than 100 years. Prior to that time period, for a couple thousand years at least, Scorpio was ruled by the planet Mars. And so for Scorpios, you're going to want to look to both Mars and Pluto as being the rulers of your sign. And so we'll get into that a little bit more as we continue this discussion, but you definitely want to make note of both of those planets. In terms of what comes next there, Sagittarius, you would be ruled by Jupiter. Capricorn would be ruled by Saturn. And Aquarius is another sign that would have multiple rulers. So Aquarius has both a traditional and a modern ruler of the sign of Aquarius. And so in modern Western astrology, we have Uranus as the ruler of Aquarius, which seems to make a lot of sense, right? It's very rebellious. It's very sort of shocking and exciting and a little bit more dynamic than the traditional chart ruler, which would be Saturn, right? And so we have Saturn as the ruler of Aquarius, and we have Uranus as the modern ruler of Aquarius. And so if you're an Aquarius rising, you're going to want to look at both of those planets. And then finally, we have the sign of Pisces. Pisces is another one that's going to have two rulers and two planets that you're going to want to look at to do these interpretations and look at the things we're going to be discussing in today's video. And so for Pisces, you are ruled by both Jupiter in traditional astrology. So for at least a couple thousand years, Pisces was ruled by Jupiter. And in modern Western astrology, since the discovery of Neptune, Neptune has become the modern ruler of Pisces. And so for Pisces people, for Pisces rising people, you're going to want to look to both Jupiter and Neptune when you're looking at the concepts that we're going to be discussing in this video today. And so the chart ruler, so what does that even mean? So first and foremost, this planet in your birth chart is actually going to carry some extra significance. It's going to be much more important to look at than some of the other planets. It's going to have a much greater impact on your life, on your life experience, and on you personally. And so when you have transits that come in, that hit that planet in your birth chart, they might impact you much more significantly significantly than they would when they hit other planets in your chart. And you might wonder why sometimes you have transits to certain planets and they're in one house or they're in one area of your chart and they're impacting you in ways that don't make sense to you or that you couldn't have predicted or you didn't predict, and they're affecting you in other areas. The concept of chart rulership actually does a lot to answer that question and help you to understand a fuller scope and a more detailed interpretation of what's going to be happening, not just by transit, but just the major life themes, the experiences that you're going to have on a more practical, mundane, actual, like physical level in your life. And so this is something that's really important to understand if you're going to get a full understanding or a full picture of your birth chart, your astrological blueprint, and what that means for you, and also the way it's going to be activated by transit. And so with the chart ruler in particular, this is going to be one of the stronger energies. It rules your ascendant. The ascendant is you. The ascendant is the self, right? The first house represents you in the chart, you as a person. It represents your physical body. It represents your persona, your personality, and the conditioning that you receive in early childhood that causes you to develop your personality in one way or another. It has a lot of influence on who you are, your major life themes, your direction in life, your talents and your skill sets and the things that you gravitate toward. And so a lot of you should already have at least some understanding of your ascendant sign and what that means. And so what the ascendant ruler does is it adds an additional layer of interpretation and an additional layer of important information to that concept of that first house and that ascendant and all of those topics that I just mentioned. And so when you look to the chart ruler and the placement of the chart ruler, that's going to give you another indication of specific, first off, indicators for the personality and things that are really important to that person and the way other people view them. Also major life themes and things that come around usually more than once or that are really prominent in a person's life can be indicated by the house placement of the chart ruler, which is something we're going to discuss in this video. And aspects to the chart ruler can also give important indications as to the person's personality, the way that they show up, their physical health and their body, even their appearance. And so this is a really important planet in the chart. And that planet, of course, is going to be different for each person depending on their ascendant sign. And so hopefully what I'm saying so far is helpful to you and is making sense. And so to determine the chart ruler, you look to the ascendant, you figure out which planet that I just went through rules your ascendant sign, and then you look to that planet. In addition to that planet being much more prominent in your birth chart, transits from that planet might actually be more prominent or more significant for you. And so that's something that's going to have a bigger impact on your life direction, your major life themes, where you're focusing your energy during that period, especially if you have like a faster moving planet like Mercury. That's part of the reason why Gemini rising people might be more scattered, jumping from topic to topic, because their chart ruler is just zooming around their chart at any given point in time by transit, right? So these things kind of start to make more sense when you understand concepts like chart rulership and like house rulership and the connections between the planets and the signs and why they rule those signs. And so looking to those transits might be more important. Another example is planetary stations. When the ruler of your chart stations, it's a much more significant event for you as opposed to somebody else who isn't ruled by that planet. You know, the same thing goes for the retrograde periods themselves might be a little bit more impactful and maybe, you know, sometimes disorienting depending on which planet is retrograde and what it's doing more specifically during that time for somebody who is ruled by that planet. So if you are that Gemini rising, the Mercury retrogrades might be a little bit more challenging for you as opposed to somebody who doesn't have such a strong affiliation with Mercury based on their birth chart. So that planet is a point of interest. It's a point where it is amplified in energy and it is associated with topics that are very personal to you, even if it's placed somewhere that's, you know, not so personal to you, even if it's in the sixth house of health or work, even if it's somewhere like the 10th house of career, it's not necessarily representing you as a human being, as a standalone thing, as a standalone planet. Like Mars isn't always necessarily your personality and who you are and what drives you. Well, it is what drives you, but it's not always so personal in its connection and so prominent in its impact, unless it's ruling something really important like your ascendant, right? And so that's what we're really focusing on here. And I do want to pull up just a really quick little presentation, just short, that I'm going to be showing you here. And this is actually an excerpt from the presentation that I gave in my House Rulerships course. Again, if you want to get into that full course and understand all the rulerships in your chart and how they operate and what they mean for you, you can find that link down in the description below. Okay, so what is the chart ruler? First and foremost, the planetary ruler of the first house and ascendant is a particularly important planet, and it represents the individual. So this planet in the chart essentially represents you as a person. If you're looking at the houses and the astrology in terms of like traditional Hellenistic astrology and some other forms of traditional astrology, the first house is always you, and the other houses are topics and people and other things that are outside of you, but are relating to you in some way. And so that's an important concept to understand here too. So the planetary ruler of the first house is a planet that represents you on a more personal level. The placement of the chart ruler gives you important information, like I mentioned before, about major life themes, the individual's personality, the way that they show up in the world, the way that other people perceive them, their big characteristics, their goals, life direction, major life themes, even their health and the appearance of their physical body can all show up with that chart ruler. The ascendant does provide important insight into all of those topics, and so does the first house, but this gives you additional modifying energy that gives you more nuance and more detail in your interpretation, and it can give you information that you wouldn't otherwise have pertaining to that person and who they are and the way that they show up in the world. So this is something that's really predominant that impacts a person's character, quality, overall life trajectory. The topics associated with the house placement of the chart ruler, as I mentioned before, they become connected with or directly influence the person's personality and sense of self. And so that's an important concept here as well. The first house ruler can often indicate activities, events, or outcomes that result from a person's own volition. And as we go through the houses in just a second here, I'm going to describe what that looks like and what that means a little bit more in detail. But a really kind of straightforward example that's maybe a little dark, but ruler of the first house in the eighth is commonly associated with somebody taking their own life, because it's the eighth house is the house of death. The first house is something that the ruler of the first house is something that you're doing, that you're causing, that is happening due to your own choices or your own volition. And so it could be that you result in your own death, or your choices result in your own death, or that you very literally take your own life. That's not always the case, but that can be a prominent energy for that person, and that is one indicator of that. Another example would be that something along the lines of the ruler of the first in the seventh. It could be that you approached your marriage partner and you were the one who was sort of initiating the relationship if you have the ruler of the first in the seventh, right? And so that's another thing that you can kind of look into there, because the seventh house is marriage. Topics associated with the house placement of the chart ruler become much more important in the native's life than the themes and topics associated with other houses. So the themes associated with the house placement often stick out in some way. So these are things when you're looking at the person's overall life story, when it's all said and done, these themes are themes that are going to stick out like a sore thumb. Like you're going to notice that these things are really prominent in the person's experience more times than not. The native might be fixated or even obsessive over the topics associated with the house placement of the chart ruler. And so these are themes that they'll constantly come back to throughout their lifetime over and over again. And they might have some sort of fixation or affinity for that house and for those topics associated with that house. You can, of course, also look at sign placement of the chart ruler, aspects to the chart ruler to give additional information, but that's something that's going to be a little bit beyond the scope of this video here. Again, I have a whole course where we get into that, but for the purpose of this video, we're going to be focusing a little bit more on house placement than anything else. And then finally, the topics associated with the placement of the chart ruler often have a profound impact on the trajectory of the native's life, as well as the specific impact on the native that the native has on the world around them. And so this can show the way that the native, through their own volition, through their own choices, through their existence, impacts the world around them. This can also show major events and circumstances that might just show up once in a person's life that completely alter who they are, the way that they show up, their life trajectory in a major, huge, prominent way. And so that's something that, again, I gave a lot of examples of that in the course, but we'll cover this a little bit in this video as well. Okay, and so this is just taken from a PDF that I gave to my newsletter subscribers as a free download. I'll probably make this some sort of download and link it to a blog post or something related to this video at some point. But basically, this is just a rundown of some of the major themes that are associated with each of the 12 houses. And so basically, when you have the ruler of one house and another, the energy of those two houses combine in some way. There's a combination of those topics. They're linked together in a way where they're not able to be separated. And so with the first house, the first house is the self, the physical body, outlook in life, major life themes, all those things that I talked about. Those things will be linked to the topics associated with the house where the ruler of your ascendant is placed. And so an example of this would be, let's say, ruler of the first house in the first. That actually doesn't carry any additional significations, right? Because anytime you have the ruler of a house in its own house, you're not really adding additional layers of interpretation. And so this person is going to be very strong-willed, very independent, very self-guided, very self-directed. They're going to have a sense that they create their own destiny. They create their own fate, that they have more control over their experiences than some other people might. And sometimes they can be very self-focused. They're kind of focusing on developing themselves, developing their identity and making a name for themselves. And this can also indicate someone who's really prominent and notable in some way, because the ruler of the first house, if it's in the first house, is actually going to be in its home sign. And so that strengthens the energy of that planet and it helps it to manifest in a way that's much more positive. An example that I gave in my house rulerships course that I think is actually a good one is Madonna has that energy of the ruler of the first house in the first. And sometimes people who have this placement, especially when they're celebrities or they're well known, even just amongst their circle or in their immediate environment or their immediate field, they can be iconic in some way. And literally she was this like big, music fashion icon in the 80s and 90s. And she's still like one of the most famous people in the world. And so I felt like that was, and she's very independent, very strong will, does her own thing. All of these things were very prominent in her chart and in her experience. If you have the ruler of the first house in the second, money and material possessions can become much more prominent in terms of major life themes. And so these are things that stick out. So it could be that your life trajectory is heavily influenced by your material possessions. It could be that your identity is tied in with your material possessions. It could be that you are, very flashy and show-offy, or maybe you live with financial struggle, and that's a huge part of your identity and the way you view yourself and the way other people view you. So there's major life themes tied to finance specifically. In the third house, major life themes connected to communication, right? To connecting with groups of people, to connecting to your community. Major life themes and your personality and the way that you show up in the world could be informed by your relationship with your siblings or your extended family, or you might have a close connection to your siblings where people identify you through them even. Early education, communication, all of these third house themes can be much more predominant if you have the ruler of the ascendant in the third house. In the fourth house, your family becomes very important. Your identity is somehow tied in with your family relationships, your ancestry, or even just your property or your home or your foundation. But there's a huge connection to, especially like the parents usually, where that relationship really informs the person's character and identity, and it sticks out in some way. And their identity is very much tied in with their family. That can be a big fourth house theme with the ruler of the chart ruler of the first house in the fourth. In the fifth house, major life themes can be tied to children or your own childhood or your own children or just childhood and children in general. So you can have like a lot of themes of working with children or engaging with that childlike energy. This could also be an energy that's associated with sports, joy, creative expression, romance, play, pleasure. These are all things that are going to be much more prominent and much more important and influential in a person's life who has the ruler of the ascendant in the fifth house. In the sixth house, this one creates a focus where there's major life themes around health and nutrition. Sometimes there can be health issues, or this person can work in a healing field or in the healthcare field in some way. This is also a really pretty clear placement for most people of working really hard or being like a workaholic. And I use some examples in the house rulerships course of this. One of them was Steve Jobs, who was known to be like a huge workaholic. He would work like excessive hours really late and then call meetings really early in the morning, and everyone would get mad at him for it. And so he was known to just be very, very busy all the time. He was always working. So he's a strong example of that workaholic energy, and also how major life themes of health, because he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, and he ended up actually several years later, after battling with that for a very long time and having that be a big focal point, he ended up passing from cancer, from a health issue, right? And so that's another thing that can be associated with that sixth house energy if you have markers. I'm not saying everyone with the ruler of the first and the sixth has health problems. That is not the case. He has specific markers that are indicative of issues that might be more troublesome involving those sixth house themes. But a lot of people too, ruler of the first and the sixth might have an affinity with animals. Traditionally, that's working animals, like farm animals, like in an agricultural setting. But nowadays, that can be pets. Pets can also be fourth house. I've seen that be the case too. And then ruler of the first and the seventh. A person's identity is very tied up in their relationships when they have this placement. So relationships, partnership, marriage, contractual agreements, these things are more important and more prominent and more influential, and their life trajectory can be very impacted by their relationships. This is also an energy where I've seen people with the ruler of the first and the seventh get lost in their relationships. We all have at least one friend or someone we know in our lives who they'll start dating someone and they'll completely change their personality to reflect that of the person that they're dating, or all of a sudden their interests will start to reflect the person that they're dating, but in a way that's extreme. Sometimes these are ruler of the first house and the seventh house people. Sometimes they can be other placements that indicate that too, but I've seen that quite a bit. It's also kind of a Libra rising thing sometimes too, just as a side note there. But this is where your identity is very much influenced and tied up in your relationships, and you need relationship like more so than not to find yourself and figure out who you are and figure out your place in the world. ruler of the first and the eighth house. I did already give you that one example, which is a little dark, but this could just be, you know, a heavy focus on eighth house themes. Maybe this person is really into occult sciences. Maybe this person is really into psychology. Maybe this person is a debt collector or works in like taxes, or they're a CPA or something like that. So there could be those types of themes, major life themes involving inheritance or death of somebody close to you can be very prominent in the person's life story and completely alter the way that they show up in the world, their personality, and their life path. Ruler of the first and the ninth, this is a happier one. Fifth and the ninth are more just like happy-go-lucky energies. and so you have the ruler of the first and the ninth. There's an association here with the person's identity and their integrity, their philosophies, their belief systems. This is somebody who's going to be a constant seeker of knowledge and adventure, where they want to know everything, they want to experience everything, they grow through their experiences. This can be someone who has a huge focus on teaching or publishing or education in general. But this is somebody who is usually going to be of high integrity, and they're somebody who, you know, views life through the bigger picture a little bit more so through the lens of opportunity, and it can actually be a really nice placement. This is definitely an adventurous spirit more times than not. Even in some of the signs that would be less adventurous, like maybe Capricorn, it can still be a very adventurous energy in one form or another. Ruler of the first house in the 10th. This is a huge focus on career, public reputation, authority figures, leadership. These are people that are going to be really prominent and their name is going to be known. A lot of celebrities and people who are famous, they have this type of placement, or they have ruler of the 10th in the first. Even if you're not famous, like if you're more of an average person just doing something kind of normal with your life and you're not out there as a celebrity, you might be very well known in your field, or you might have a very strong reputation in your community, or a strong reputation just kind of in general. Like people have heard of you, they know who you are, you've done something notable. And there's a huge focus here on career. You find yourself through your work is part of your identity. A lot of entrepreneurs have this too. And where like their work is their life, right? This business is my life, that type of thing. Ruler of the first house in the 11th house. This is another one that's more pleasant. This is where the person's identity is really tied into groups and organizations, and especially their friendships and their social networks. And so there's a huge focus on friends, and they're usually very social people. They need social interaction. They need group interaction. They need to have friendship. They need to have community and communication. This is like a very heavily focused on relationships, and a lot of major life themes can be associated with their friends. A lot of major twists and turns in their life can be associated with those types of themes. This is also a house in modern astrology that's associated with altruistic and humanitarian types of pursuits. It's about what's good for the group, right? What's good for me is what's good for the group. That's a ruler of the first and the 11th house sort of mindset, or the way that they sort of view the world. And a good example of this, I think, would be Fred Rogers, who is another example that I've used in my course. And he actually has ruler of the first and the 11th in a conjunction with the ruler of the fifth. So there's that connection with kids there too. But he actually in his television show, in his children's television show, he incorporated a lot of important social issues of that time, and he would address these types of humanitarian and social issues in the way that he in the episodes that he created and what he was saying, what he was teaching to the children. And so there was also that really strong connection with friends and neighbors and things like that in his work too. So I thought that was interesting. And then moving on to ruler of the first in the 12th house. This is a challenging energy. This can make a person quite shy, especially if there are a lot of planets there, or the sun is there as well, and especially in the water signs. So this could be someone who's more shy or more reserved, especially in early childhood. They might grow out of it. They might you know, become a little more extroverted, but they're usually still mostly introverts. Not always the case in the fire signs. That's the least true, I guess. And the air signs would be second to that, but especially in the water and in the earth signs, it can be the case. There's also usually a major theme of separation or of solitude, where the person has to be sort of hidden away from the world for some reason. And sometimes it can involve 12th house institutions. One example that I used was a student who had her first 3.5 years of life, she was essentially living in a hospital because her mother was very sick with cancer. And so she was secluded, and she actually had that major life theme of having to be hidden away from the world. She spent the first 3.5 years of her life essentially hanging around a hospital because of her mother's illness. And so that's a 12th house institution, hospitals, right? Monasteries, temples, churches, prisons, any place that you go to be away from the world. And they can be anywhere on the spectrum, from the sacred to the profane. It's like everything. So it rules everything from like prisons and brothels and rehabilitation centers to spiritual retreat centers and ashrams, right? So it really just kind of depends. But there's usually a spiritual connection, and these people are deeply, deeply empathic, and they feel things very intensely. And so these are people that need a lot of solitude and need a lot of downtime. They need time on their own. So that is my rundown of the energy of the chart ruler in all 12 signs. I hope you found this information to be helpful or useful to you in some way. And at the very least, I hope it sets you off in your studies, so that way you can learn a little bit more about chart rulerships and house rulerships and how this impacts you, so you can understand yourself and the world around you a lot more deeply and effectively. So thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you next time. Bye.